putting on my top hat, tying up my white tie, brushing up my tail. Oh, I'm dirtying my shirt.
Welcome to Hatcast.
It's a podcast about hats.
I'm Charles Berman.
And I'm Carl Bernhardsen.
And we're here to talk about hats.
Hats.
A particular kind of hat this time.
Well, it's always a particular kind of hat. We really haven't had the hats in general.
It always has been so far.
It doesn't have to be. We've talked about how the show could take a variety of forms. It hasn't yet. It's always just been we pick one hat and we talk about it. Although we've branched out into having other people talk about the hat with us.
Yes,
which is
will
fun.
Happen again, yeah.
And sometimes we read comments from our listeners if they bother to write us.
Which you can do at hatcast@yandex.com. But before we get to our hat of the day, or the podcast, or however frequently you listen, let's talk about the hats we wore today. What hat did you wear today?
Today, I just wore, once again, my baseball cap with the Shakespeare Theater written on it. I think that's what I've been wearing the last couple of weeks as it's gotten sunnier. I just sort of put that on when I'm outside.
Right.
So nothing too special. I am going to pull out some more of my spring hats now that it is decidedly spring. So we'll see those and a little bit more variation in hats as we come along. What did you wear today, Charles?
I wore, well, you had mentioned that hat so many times, and I had mentioned this, that I had
I wore this
Stratford Shakespeare Festival 12th Night hat.
Yes, it's like our hats are brothers.
Yes, and this is, it's become pretty worn. It's actually so worn that I don't wear it that much anymore.
It is, for the listener, it is in pretty rough shape. The parts that look like they were white are now a yellowish brown, and the parts that look like they were red are now a reddish gray.
Yes, that is true. So this has seen a bunch of wear. I wouldn't wear it if I needed to look in particularly good.
Yeah, but for going for a brief walk or
or to go to the beach or somewhere where it might be messy or salty.
Right.
Or
metal detecting. It'd be a good behavior detecting.
Yes.
You wouldn't be worried about digging in the dirt with it.
But anyway, I got this at the Stratford Shakespeare Festival.
Really?
I went with my friend Chris, not the one that we were with on the last episode. And I saw the 12th Night production, which was excellent. And also Titus Andronicus.
Really?
Which I think was an even better production of a much less fun play.
No, not as fun as 12th Night.
No.
Little grim.
Yes. Well, let's get to talking about the hat of the day, which is one that I can happily say I've never had to wear.
No, I've never had to wear one either. This has less to do with me being particularly good as it just not being standard teaching practice, but we are talking about the
dunce cap.
Yes. Good answer. You wouldn't wear the dunce cap.
Thank you. Yes. Now everyone is familiar with what a dunce cap looks like, I hope.
It's a white cone, usually made of paper, sometimes with dunce written on it, sometimes the letter D,
yes,
which I assume stands for dunce.
And it is worn, the idea of it, now everyone has seen it, it's usually not made by a milliner.
No, it's not. It's, I assume that the teacher in the classroom would take a big sheet of white paper and roll it up into a cone and say, here, bad student, put this on your head.
Yes. It's the sort of thing that no one wants to wear.
Right.
And it's not initially manufactured as a hat. It's sort of made out of paper, construction paper or poster board?
I think so. It opens up the whole category of paper hats.
Yes, which is too broad to just have paper hat.
Right.
I mean, there are some noble paper hats, like the paper newspaper hat.
Right. When did people first start folding newspaper into a hat to put it on their head? Probably as soon as newspapers were being thrown out and children had access to them.
I would think.
Right.
There's the paper Burger King crown.
Yes. There's the paper food service worker hat that was, I assume, popular before the hairnet.
Now, we'll start with what Wikipedia says about this, which is a dunce cap is a pointed hat formerly used as an article of discipline in schools. In popular culture, it's typically made of paper and marked with a D or the word dunce and given to unruly school children to wear. Frequently, the dunce was made to stand in the corner facing the wall. The hope was that no one would want to be labeled the dunce in the class, even for a short period of time, and would thus avoid misbehavior.
It would be extremely embarrassing to wear that hat and stand in the corner.
It indicates that you are, in this case, I always thought that it would indicate that you're not very smart. You have given a wrong answer.
Yeah,
in this case, it says Examples of behavior which could warrant the dust cap included throwing spitballs, passing notes, or pulling of hair. Class clowns were frequently admonished with the dunce cap.
Well, this one Wikipedia article is not necessarily the authority on
dunce caps. No, often these Wikipedia... Now, I love Wikipedia.
Wikipedia is wonderful.
It's wonderful to read. I think when we're talking about articles like types of hat, the authors sometimes seem to be writing off the seat of their pants.
Yes. Which we're discovering as we read more and more Wikipedia articles about hats. But we do try to dive into other scholarship.
Yes, of course, yes.
But no, it's a good jumping off point. And yeah, I guess it could be used for children who were misbehaving, as well as children who were dull, right? I think it was both, depending on the teacher and what the teacher valued, right?
Right.
If the teacher was more about maintaining order in the classroom and then sort of helping everybody learn, I don't think it would be used as much on the children who got questions wrong.
Right.
But if you had a teacher who was particularly strict about studying and coming in and having memorized everything. And at this time period, when the dunce cap was in use, there was a lot more rote memorization, which was something you just had to do. You had to put the work in for. And so you could punish someone for not doing it if they didn't know.
Now it says, according to the Straight Dope, Duns Scotus recommended the use of wearing conical hats to stimulate the brain, so-called thinking caps.
Like a wizard's hat.
Right. This notion is the likely source of the pointed hats traditionally worn by wizards, etc.
Right.
However, the Oxford English Dictionary, second edition, records that the term dunce cap itself did not enter the English language until after the term dunce had become a synonym for fool or dimwit. In fact, dunce cap is not recorded before the 1840 novel The Old Curiosity Shop by Charles Dickens. John Ford's 1624 play, The Sun's Darling, is the first recorded mention of the related term, dunce table, a table provided for duller or poorer students. The cap can also be seen in Winbenstein's Money, a game show. If a player answers in the form of a question, since Jeopardy, which it doesn't gloss, requires you to answer in the form of a question, is the show's rival.
An interesting diversion there. No, I agree that the name dunce cap probably came after the word dunce was used as
an insult. I think almost certainly. Yes.
This idea that it had to do with wizards and this Catholic theologian and all of these many things is a little bit far-fetched, especially since it doesn't really appear as a word until the 1840s.
Right. Well, let's delve into a little bit of this. Now, Duns Scotus...
was a real man.
It was called John, and Duns Scotus was because he was born in Duns, Scotland, and the Scotus is Latin for that. His teaching, now Cecil Adams tells us, his teachings were respected until about the 16th century when they were attacked by reformers and humanists as being sophists and needlessly complex. The Dunsmen, or Dunces, rallied against the attack. Their name was by then already associated with hair-splittingness and specious reasoning. But all their struggle against the new learning only made their name synonymous with idiot.
Hmm.
So I think it's fair to say in Etym Online, the online etymology dictionary, agrees with the etymology of dunce is coming from Duns Scotus.
Right, but I don't think that the dunce cap was a hat that Duns Scotus wore.
No, and we will have to discuss the thinking cap or wizard's cap
in a future
episode.
Dunce cap actually has revealed a lot of things that we need to talk about. We've got to talk about paper hats, wizard's caps, thinking cap, all that kind of thing.
Yeah, and 10,000 and 10,000 times 10,000 are the things that we could discuss about hats. Once you open up this chink into the world, the possibilities flower out infinitely.
That is the point of Hatcast.
Yes.
There are an infinite number of things you can put on your head, so we'll never run out of material.
Yes. Maybe we'll do an episode about hair.
Well, we do want to talk about wigs.
I just had
somebody that I had lunch with today who listens to the program ask whether we're going to do wigs. And I was like, well, you clearly haven't listened to every episode because in almost every other episode we talk about talking about wigs. And we will get to it. I do promise.
But the etymology tells us dullard, 1570s, from earlier Duns' disciple, follower of John Duns Scotus, a Scottish scholar of philosophy and theology, supposed to have been born at Duns in Berwickshire. By 16th century, humanist reaction against medieval theology singled him out as the type of the hair-splitting scholastic. It became a general term of reproach applied to more conservative philosophical opponents by the 1520s, later extended to any dull-witted student. So that's established. I don't think the image of it coming from the cone. Yeah.
Oh, it looks like this source here has a better explanation of where the cone came from.
Yeah, we're looking at May We Borrow Your Language, How English Steals Words from All Over the World by Philip Gooden. It says, well, it's talking about Dunce, and it mentions, of course, Alexander Pope's long poem from 1728. The
Dunciad.
The Dunciad. You're an Alexander Pope fan.
I sure am.
So that's an excellent poem to delve into, and that is well-known evidence that the word dunce was in circulation in the 18th century. And I think if you call someone a dunce today, it remains as...
It would remain
good
insulting.
An insult. Yes, yeah, ever.
You might be perceived as a little bit old-fashioned for using the term dunce. If I were to say, oh, Todd, you're such a dunce. You've dropped all the eggs.
I don't think you call it someone to their face. Maybe right. That would be... But if you say Todd is a dunce, I think the word retains its insulting quality.
Right.
100%.
It may not be the sharpest insult you can use, but it is an insult nonetheless.
This says, the dunce's cap, the conical hat sometimes emblazoned with a large capital D, doesn't appear until later, though by 1841, when Charles Dickens published The Old Curiosity Shop.
Which is the first printed appearance of dunce's cap, right?
That's what it says.
Okay.
It must have been a part of the regular equipment of the schoolroom. Little Nell and her grandfather are given hospitality by a poor schoolmaster in whose room, among other things, on hooks upon the wall and all their terrors were the cane and ruler, and near them, on a small shelf of its own, the dunce's cap, made of old newspapers and decorated with glaring wafers of the largest size.
So this doesn't necessarily suggest that it's cone-shaped, though, just that it's a paper hat.
Made of newspaper.
Made of newspaper.
It could have been cone-shaped, and every image I've seen of a dunce's cap has been cone-shaped.
I assume a cone is the easiest shape to make if you're going to make a hat out of paper. If you have a rectangle and you need to make it somewhat circular, a cone is your go-to option.
And then it says, the counterpart to the dunce's cap is the thinking cap, almost certainly related to the considering cap, an imaginary item of wear first mentioned in 1600 in a book by Robert Armin, who played the clown roles in Shakespeare's acting company. So, the actual original shape of this dunce's cap, we don't know what it was. I assume it was probably a cone, because that's what has traditionally remained.
Right.
We know the word dunce is older. We know where it came from. We know that children were treated as dunces in school back to the 17th century.
Right, when and embarrassment and punishment was more common in the schoolroom.
And this John Ford play we have from 1624, a character says, a phlegmatic, cold piece of stuff. His father, methinks, should be one of the dunce table, and one that never drunk strong beer in his life, but at festival times. And then he caught the heart burning, a whole vacation, and half a term after. So I agree with the sentiment here that failure to engage in drinking could make one a dunce.
And it does prove that dunce cap popped up somewhere between 1640 and 1840?
1624 and 1840, yeah.
And I guess, I mean, it wouldn't... The wider spread education of children in schools definitely had something to do with it becoming a thing that exists.
Yes. Now, we've established some things. We've established Charles Dickens in 1840 or 1841 writing about the dunce's cap as our earliest citation. However, if you search Google Books, you can problematize this somewhat, because there's a book in there from 1833 called America and the Americans by James Boardman, citizen of the world. He's describing a boat or a ship of some variety, and he says, in lieu of a bowsprit, a long pole projects from the stem, upon the end of which is a cone, something like a schoolboy's dunce cap, but which is dignified with the title of the Cap of Liberty.
Would you look at that?
Yes, by which... Incidentally, they're talking about the Phrygian cap.
Right.
Or Cap of Liberty.
Another generally cone-shaped
hat. Hat, yeah. Yes. But this is a clear reference to a dunce's cap in 1833, which...
Predates the Dickens reference.
Yes, and...
Puts it in America as well as the UK.
Yes, and which tells us the physical image of it.
Right. That it was, in fact, a generally cone-shaped
hat. Yes.
Huh.
Which Dickens does not bother to do. So this is an antedating. Now, we're recording, Carl, at your house, so I don't have my software copy of the Oxford English Dictionary.
Okay. Would that provide us with further insight?
Well, it would tell us whether they are still claiming that the first citation is from 1840.
Could we have sort of scooped the OED by Googling?
It's possible that we have. Yes.
What power? Should we write to them? Should that, I mean, if they're still claiming that, they need to be corrected. This is a matter of international scholarship.
Well, I think there is a mechanism for doing that. I don't know what it is, because I've never been the one to do it. It's sort of been a dream in the back of my mind, but...
Could we have stumbled upon something that someone else didn't realize about a topic that kind of matters?
Maybe.
Matters to us and matters to our listeners. If you're listening to Hatcast, you certainly want us to have as much notoriety as possible amongst hat researchers. It sort of elevates the level of program that you're listening to. And so what was America and the Americans?
Yeah, here it is. I think this is pretty undeniable. We're looking at the title page, America and the Americans, by a citizen of the world, printed in London, 1833.
Yeah.
Dedicated to Lafayette, the companion of Washington and the friend of mankind. So this is a pro-U.S. sort of book, I think. In the course of my travels and residence in the United States of America, which country I visited solely with commercial views and unprovided with any direct demands for what are termed civilities, notwithstanding the plague spot slavery in one district, I saw so much to cheer the philanthropist and so much to delight the lover of liberty, so much to interest even the money-spending as well as the money-getting class. In short, I saw a nation so much further advanced in all the useful arts as well as the elegancies of life than I, in common with the great majority of Englishmen, were willing to believe, that my impressions on the whole were decidedly favorable and were freely communicated to all with whom I conversed.
Hmm. Well, it seems like it's worth a read.
Oh, of course, yes. I wondered when this was written. This must be a response to Domestic Manners of the Americans by Francis Trollope, which I've actually been meaning to read quite soon, which was famously taking of a jaundiced view of the Americans.
Okay. And this was...
I think this was written to...
counter some of the claims.
Of Frances Trollope, yes. Because her impressions were not favorable, and her book was very, very popular.
Hmm. Well, this has been a sort of fun little tangent, although we should probably get back onto the topic at hand.
Yes.
Otherwise, our listeners might think that we're dunces.
Which we certainly wouldn't want.
No. But you know what I'm interested in finding? I don't know if we can find it. But when did it first... No, I guess we already proved that. I was going to suggest earlier that we try and find proof that it was a cone by looking up images and finding the earliest image that we could find that had it depicted as a cone. But we've got it pegged as early as 1833 that it is conical.
Yeah.
So
we've got a story called What Cunliffe Lockhart Did for Amy Audley in 1863, which still maintains this association with the thinking cap. It has this one character saying, "You've your dunce's cap on tonight, sir, certainly." The dunce's cap seemed to resolve itself into a meditation cap, however, for after taking a turn or two across the room, he sat down again at the table, which was littered and strewn with books, sheets of paper, pens and ink, and sat some minutes with his head in his hands and was only roused by a little musical clock on the mantelpiece, striking 12 and then playing in a serio-lively strain, Home Sweet Home.
You know, this is definitely interesting. The idea that this sort of mythical hat developed based on the dunce's cap.
Yes.
That there was some kind of wizard's hat may have even happened the other way around, right?
Yes.
That's very interesting. And that they sort of reverse engineered the story about Dunce, knowing that his name was the root for dunce.
I think it would have been dunce because
the
Latin doesn't make that final consonant voiced the way English does. D-U-N-S, but I think it's spelled D-U-N-C-E so that we don't say duns when we read it in English letters.
Right.
The Weird World of Words, A Guided Tour by Michael Simons also claims that the first person to wear the dunce's cap was the man after whom it was actually named, John Dunce Scotus, an Oxford theologian of the 14th century who thought the conical hat would help him receive messages from God.
Oh, sort of like a bullhorn pointed right at your head.
Yes.
And the bit you speak into pointed at the sky. But I see the point.
That seems to be a total myth.
Yes, complete fabrication.
But it just...
There seems to be no proof for this thinking cap or wizard cap.
It spreads like a virus. It reminds me of... You've heard of the Tale of the Tub?
I have not. Enlighten me.
H.L. Mencken in, I think, the 1920s. Oh, no, it looks like it was 1917. He wrote a story, called A Neglected Anniversary. It was a fabricated history of the bathtub, and even up till the present day, it is still being quoted as the history of the bathtub. Because once it saw print, it is much easier to reproduce a fact you've seen somewhere than it is to debunk it and replace it with real history. Especially when real history is, we're not quite sure, but it's not that.
Right. And at a time when you didn't have all of this research power at your fingertips, how do you sit and disprove it?
It's in print. You can cite it.
Yeah.
We've got a story from 1880 from the Catholic Children's Magazine that's only a page. I almost want to reproduce it in the podcast.
Reproduce the whole thing?
Well, it might be a bit long.
It's a little long. Let's find the bits where they talk about the dunce's cap. Hee hee hee! Oh, I think that's laughter. Hee hee hee! Was the stupid response. Don't he look funny? His headdress like a dunce's cap. Huh.
Yeah.
Yeah, it may not be worth reproducing.
No, probably not, although it is illustrated.
This illustration is fantastic.
Wearing a fantastic, I believe that's a bicorn hat.
Yeah.
With an enormous feather.
Yes. This hat is too big for this little boy, who also seems to have a wooden sword and is about to be hit over the head by what I assume is the schoolmaster with a stick.
Yes. Bring the dunce's cap here, said the master, who had from the school window himself witnessed Billy's treatment of the dog. Put it on his head. Come, sir, hold out your hand. Now the other. There, there. And he's striking him on the hands, if
right.
You can't.
There, there, there.
But I think that indicates the dunce cap also for general mean or base behavior rather than purely stupidity.
Right. Well, I think we've learned quite a lot about the dunce cap. Dunce's cap. Dunce cap. Dunscotus cap.
Oh, yes.
Yeah. I'm pretty excited that we've pushed the date for first appearance in print back a little farther. I feel like that's an actual contribution to scholarship that we just made.
I think that might be an actual contribution to scholarship.
Yeah.
I didn't think we would achieve that so early on Hatcast.
No, you know, I didn't either. Although, you know, we sort of set the tone with Wide Awake. This probably is not as serious a look into a hat and its history as our look into the Wide Awake hat was, but...
The dunce's cap is not a serious hat.
No, that's true. Yeah. It doesn't warrant it. But no, I'm pretty happy. We made a little discovery.
Yes.
I'm not sure how we rate a dunce's cap,
though. We'll do it like normal. Now,
I guess so.
We always discuss what we would think if you saw someone walking down the street wearing a dunce's cap.
I would think, oh, look, a dunce.
Yeah.
What has he done?
It's almost hard to imagine. It's so ridiculous.
Well, yeah, and in the wild, it doesn't have to mean walking down the street, right? You could be at a school and you see a school child wearing a dunce's cap in the corner, and you might think, oh, what regressive educational policies this institution has.
I don't think it's really that bad. I mean, it's embarrassing.
It is.
The idea is that you would want to avoid embarrassment, and so you learn well.
True.
I suppose there are better motivators these days. You would think, you would hope
this
the students would from love of knowledge and learning.
Right, but that doesn't happen.
But this podcast is a pro love of knowledge and learning.
Right. So we're biased. We assume everybody wants to learn and loves learning.
I didn't have a hat history course in school, though.
No, well, sooner or later, though, I'm sure we'll add at Hat University.
Yeah.
But no, I guess it's not the worst thing. And studies have consistently shown that one of the things that motivates people to change faster than anything else is social embarrassment.
Hence, fashions and hats changing.
Yep. Right, because people just voluntarily buy new things because they don't want people to think they look funny.
Yes, there's a reason that things that are out of fashion are called old hat.
Right. Oh, and what's more out of fashion than a paper cone?
Yeah, that is not really old, but not worn intentionally and a source of embarrassment. So if you wear it walking down the street, you certainly are doing something odd. If I saw that, I would think the person was either intentionally being strange, like Vermin Supreme.
Right.
Who wears a boot on his head. Yeah. It's a hat not even manufactured with the intention of its being a hat.
Right.
Or that they are playing a dunce in a performance of some kind and are walking back from lunch break and forgot to take it off and going back to the theater or something like that.
Yeah. So I think for style, I'm going to have to give it a 1.
I think that I will have to agree with you. I think there is no style value to the dunce cap, and in fact, I think there never was a style value to the dunce cap.
Right, it's meant to be anti-style. In fact, can we give a 0.5 on a 1 to 10 scale? I don't think so. I think 1 is what it's going to have to be for me.
But yeah.
Because I don't fully understand the scale that we created. So, 1.
Dunce cap is fine. It's interesting how the dunce cap hasn't really been used much for years, but it's still very ubiquitous in
I guess that's something we didn't really touch on. We still understand it, but I've never seen one, right? I've never seen someone actually wearing one. I've never known of someone who was made to wear one in school. I guess it's just cartoons and illustrations, right, that really have kept it alive in our consciousness.
I think it is in films. I'm sure I've met people who have had to wear them in school. It's not a question I commonly ask people. Have you ever made wear the dunce cap? Because if you have, it's not something you want to announce. Just looking at Google images of dunce caps, there are plenty of ones of politicians wearing them as shorthand in political cartoons.
Right. There's a lot of just sort of stock images.
President Obama wearing one.
I think we've seen at least the last 3 presidents in some cartoon wearing one.
I don't know who that is.
I think it's a video game character.
Ah, well, maybe he's a stupid video game character.
Probably. But yeah, lots of them, but not too many recent school children being punished with a dunce cap.
No, I think most teachers are just... Well, here's an image of Ben Stein putting it on someone.
Right.
That's, of course, in a
TV program. Yeah.
So yes, I agree with you. This is one that, in fact, it's particularly designed to be unstylish so that people will not want to wear it.
Right.
And then I think practicality, I'm going to give it a 3. And here's my reason.
Okay, I'm curious because...
The practical purpose of it is clear. It's not meant to keep sun or rain off of you.
Right.
It's not meant to keep your head warm.
But
it is meant to embarrass you into learning.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that there is an extent to which it could help do that. So I am going to give it some points for that. But I think that there are better ways to encourage learning. And hence, it's not being used so much anymore. So I'm not going to give it a high rating.
Right.
But I am going to give it those 3 points.
Yeah, I think as far as just general headgear, it is useless because it's made of paper. It has no brim. It's very tall. You're going to bump it on things.
Yes.
It'll probably fall off, blow off in the wind. If it rains, it'll melt. Not a good hat. And yes, I guess if you want to embarrass somebody as an authority figure by making them put something on their head, yes, it would work very well. I don't think it's the best policy, so I'll give it a 2 because it does have a purpose, not no purpose. I'll give it a 2.
So the dunce cap overall, you're giving it a little bit less than I did on that score, but you do see that,
Yeah, you've made your point. I do agree. Yeah.
The dunce cap overall gets a 1.75.
Oh.
A terrible rating.
If the dunce cap was in my class, I'd have made it wear a dunce cap.
Yes. Well, so we don't... The dunce cap isn't the nicest hat we've mentioned, and neither of us has worn one.
We could have made one to look at and handle, but I guess that would have been extra effort. Write in to us if you ever were made to wear a dunce cap.
Oh, that would be interesting, yes.
Yeah, let us know your stories about childhood humiliation.
Was it a great mortification to you? Or was it just something silly that you didn't care about very much?
Right. And could it be a badge of honor for, you know, unruly kids who want everyone to know how good they are at clowning around?
Interesting.
Yeah.
Well, I will try and see if there's a mechanism for reporting that antedating to the OED.
Mm-hmm.
I'll first check the OED and see if they have it already.
Right. Yeah, that's true. We may just have been looking at outdated information.
But that's the dunce cap. And we'll be back next podcast with more discussion of hats.
Yeah, well, that's what we'll be doing.
If you'd like to get in touch with us, you can do it by emailing hatcast@yandex.com.
All right. Well, thanks for listening, and
goodbye.
Bye.
Everybody has the right to be wrong at least once. Everybody has the right to be dunce-like, once-like. Not being too smart is, it's a no disgrace.